We'd invite you to take your Bible and study it with us. Make sure what we're saying is the truth. Is that if it is, if it's God's word, the same will judge us in the last day. So today we're looking at a very challenging time in history for our country. In particular, we're wondering what's going on, what is happening. And the answer is in the Bible. For example, in Romans chapter 1, verse 18, the Apostle Paul describes the decline of man. The problem has always been sin changes people, and it doesn't change them for the better. And when it changes people, people change and the world gets worse. Well, Romans chapter 1, verse 18, here's a forgotten topic. It says, "For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who suppress the truth in unrighteousness." Now that describes what's happening. The truth is here, but we don't want to face the truth. We want to suppress the truth. And when that's the case, then things get bad, things get worse, and sometimes it causes nations to fall. Sin brings about God's wrath. Why? Because it's a choice. It's a choice to leave God out. It's a choice to leave God behind. It's a choice to not have a right relationship with a holy, righteous God. It's a choice over good people choosing our own way. It's a choice over your better potential. So Don, what do you have on this? Why is it that the world is getting so corrupt now?
We most enjoy thinking about the wonderful blessings the love of God provides. However, many don't want to meditate on God's fierce wrath and the pain and suffering that He is capable of inflicting upon us. Romans 11, verse 22 said that we are to behold the wrath of God, the goodness and the wrath. In years past, some preachers were described as hellfire and brimstone preachers. This description is seldom used today, and that's because preachers fear preaching about hell because it'll make their listeners uncomfortable. Therefore, many are not afraid to disobey God. They have no fear of God or His wrath. And in Romans chapter 3 and verse 18, he mentions that these had no fear of God. And I think that's their main problem today. We don't fear God. Many are not afraid to speak the name of God in vain, which shows that they don't fear God. In one of the Ten Commandments in Exodus 20 and verse 7, we're told, "Thou shalt not take the name of the Lord thy God in vain, for he will not hold him guiltless that takes his name in vain." When Israel worshiped the golden calf that Aaron had made, God told Moses, "Now therefore let me alone, that my wrath may burn hot against them, and I may consume them." Exodus chapter 32. God was going to make a new nation out of Moses' seed. But he was going to consume all of these Israelites. But Moses interceded on their behalf, and God didn't relent from consuming them. In Revelation, one reads about the fierceness of his wrath. Chapter 16, verse 19. Chapter 19, verse 15. We are to serve God with reverence and godly fear, for our God is a consuming fire. In Hebrews 12, 28 and 29, it's a fearful thing to fall in the hands of the living God. God's fierce wrath is just, though, because it is righteous indignation against sin. God abhors sin because of the results of it. It separates us from His fellowship. In Isaiah 59, 1 and 2 says, "The hand of the Lord is not shortened that he cannot save, nor his ear heavy that he cannot hear. But your iniquities have separated between you and your God, and your sins have hid his face from you so that he will not hear." So the problem was not with God and his inability to save them, but the problem was these people were guilty of sin, and it had separated them from a holy God. God's wrath is against sin because it will cause us to be cast into an eternal lake of fire, which burns with fire and brimstone, Revelation 21:8. Matthew 25:46, Jesus said to those, will say to those on his left hand, depart from me, ye cursed, into the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels.
So the wrath of God, according to all of those texts in Romans chapter 1, the wrath of God is clearly revealed. Now let's think about some cases now of that we know about the wrath of God. For example, you can go around today and pick up stones and rocks, and sometimes you'll find a fossil. Sometimes you might be up in a mountain area, but those fossils are crying out. The rocks are calling out and saying, God's wrath was poured out in the days of the flood. You see all of this in the nature and in the rocks because the flood happened. That was a display of God's wrath. Genesis chapter 6 says, every thought of man was only evil continually. And so the wrath of God was poured out that caused the great worldwide flood. And flood traditions have been ever since then, all over the world, people know about the great flood. Another thing, you can see in Genesis chapter 19, God poured out his wrath against Sodom and Gomorrah. That was a town known for its sexual immorality. And if you look at that and if you can see that God poured out his wrath there, then you know then that it is not going to be good for us if we choose the same sins and we choose to neglect God and push him away. So over and over again, we can see displays, things that God has put on. You can go to those regions and see brimstone. Why? Because it's a reminder that God poured out his wrath against all ungodliness. And now we're toying with it and we're developing the same disposition toward God, pushing him away, talking as if there is no God, acting as if he's not there. And the consequences are that we just make ourselves worse and worse. So what do we expect? So you can look at also at cities like Nineveh, completely wiped out. Cities like Babylon, cities like Tyre and Sidon, cities like Jerusalem. All of those cities have been destroyed, and you can see the remains to tell you God's wrath was put on display there. So yes, God hasn't changed a bit, but we've changed, and from time to time, we reflect our disposition toward God in no uncertain terms, and the result is what you see today. You can see the animosity, the hatred buildup. You can see people not respecting authority, not respecting each other, and certainly not respecting God. And the consequences means we destroy ourselves. What else you have on this, Doc?
Well, we should be very thankful that our Heavenly Father is slow to anger. In Nehemiah chapter 9, and I'm reading verse 17, it starts out telling how the Israelites had rebelled against God. And then it says, but you are God, ready to pardon, gracious and merciful, slow to anger, abundant in kindness, and did not forsake them. So God returned good for the evil they were doing to him. In order to be like him, we too must be slow to anger. In James chapter 1, verses 19 and 20, it says there that, my beloved brethren, but let every man be swift to speak, slow to hear, and slow to wrath. For the wrath of man worketh not the righteousness of God. So we need to be slow to anger, are we? Jesus became angry on a few occasions when he found the Jews desecrating the temple by selling animals there on the temple grounds for sacrifices and money changers there. He made a scourge of cords, and he drove them out single-handedly. He was angry. They were making his father's house a house of merchandise, and it was supposed to be a house of prayer. But they couldn't be reverent under those conditions of selling animals and sacrificing them. We must abhor what is evil, cleave to that which is good. Romans 12 and verse 9. I wonder, do you fear the wrath of God? You should.
Yeah, the problem has always been sin. God's wrath has been poured out plenty of times for us to know that we'll pay a consequence if we are not forgiven of our sins. So we've got the problem, and then we've got the answer. The solution is turning back to God through Jesus Christ. Jesus is the answer to the world's problem. And I hope that we'll realize, I hope you want to study more about that, and we'll deal with that more thoroughly in some other lessons, but we got to lay out the problem. We got to demonstrate what is the problem, and the problem is sin. If you would like to study more on this topic, please contact me by emailing me at terrywbenton@gmail.com. God bless you in your study of the Word of God.
Thank you.